little shout of victory laughter tonight. Yeah, we sing hallelujah,
hallelujah.
And worship just a little bit more here in a minute, but we got some business to take care of first. You know, there's business in the kingdom of God. Somebody say amen. Sometimes you just got to take care of it. Sometimes you just got to get it accomplished. You know what I mean? As you know, or as you've seen, Pastor Parsley's not with us tonight. Let me tell you who he's with. He's with a group of preachers. Some of them's names I want to just share with you here. A fellow by the name of Oral Roberts, Richard Roberts, Kenneth Copeland, anybody ever heard of him? Frieda Lindsay, wife of the late Gordon Lindsay, T.L. Lowry, Miles Monroe, Mike Murdoch, John Osteen, Carlton Pearson, Fred Price, Morris Cirillo, Dr. Paul Yonggi Cho, Paul Crouch, John Hagee, Marilyn Hickey, Benny Hinn, and on the list goes. Now, would you like me to tell you a little secret? Now, don't tell anybody, but he'd rather be here with all of you. But, when God lays his hand on somebody, you got to do what God tells you to do. Amen. When God lays his hand on somebody and says, Pastor's not going to be there, it's Wednesday night, but you need to be there, then you need to be there, amen? Praise God. Because regardless of who's here, the Holy Ghost is always waiting for you to show up, amen? Praise God. But Pastor Parsley's here. He's been invited to preach to how many thousand is it? 6,000 preachers tonight? 8,000 preachers. Well, okay. 8,000 preachers tonight. And how many of you believe that God's given him a word to share with all of them? Amen. So here's what we're going to do. See, what happens when you preach to preachers? Preachers preach to other people. And if you can set a preacher on fire, put something on the inside of him that wasn't in there before, he's going to go give it to somebody else. Chances are he'll give it to a lot of somebody else's, and it'll be able to turn around and give it to a lot of somebody else's, and pretty soon that multiplication process just goes wild out of control, and the devil doesn't know what he's going to do. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to participate in what it is that Pastor Parsley's doing at the direction of God tonight, and we're going to lift him up, and we're going to believe God for the anointing of God to be upon him in a supernatural way tonight. Just the same way it is when he delivers the word of God to us here. And if you missed the Sunday morning or Sunday evening services, God help you. Because it was real good in here. I mean, if you felt like you'd been to church after you'd been to one of those services. Hallelujah. And we're going to pray and we're going to believe God. We're going to lift our voices. And we're going to believe God for the anointing of God to manifest itself in a supernatural way in the midst of that group of preachers there tonight. And we're going to believe God for revival to break out all across this nation and around the world. Can anybody say amen to that?
Amen.
Hallelujah. So I want you to raise your hands and lift up your voice and begin to pray and begin to believe God. Now don't just go no shoomy-noomy stuff. I want you to pray out of the innermost parts of your belly and believe God for the anointing of God to be there in that meeting tonight. God, we lift up our voices on behalf of that meeting that's taking place there in Tulsa, Oklahoma. We thank you, Lord God, for what it is that you're going to do there as a result of your spirit moving. We thank you, Lord God, for the anointing of God to be there in that place, anticipating those men and women gathering together. And we thank you, Father, that as they gather together, the spirit of expectancy will rise. The spirit of expectancy will rise. And miracles will happen. Gifts will be unlocked. Revelation of your word will be unfolded. We thank you, Lord God, that as Pastor Parsley speaks, he doesn't speak just as a man speaks, but he speaks as the oracles of God. He speaks as a man who is ignited and on fire of the Holy Ghost. He speaks as a dying man to dying men. And we thank you, Lord God, that the supernatural power of God will be manifested in an unusual way in that meeting, in the name of Jesus Christ. Lift up your voices and shout amen. Praise God. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. You expect to hear some good reports. Amen. Those of you who work on those breakthrough phone lines, you expect to hear reports about, well, I don't know what happened to my pastor, but he went somewhere and God got a hold of him or turned him inside out or upside down or something happened, because we've noticed a difference. Amen.
Yes.
Well, somebody shout, go Ray!
Go
Ray! Are you not done, are you? I realize it's 86 degrees and the wind's blowing outside. But that's what happens in the summertime, you know? And God isn't moved by seasons, you know? He's just the same all the time. He wants to change your life all the time. He wants to hear and answer the cry of your heart all the time. He wants to show himself strong on your behalf all the time. He wants to save your family members all the time. Is anybody happy about it?
Yeah.
Well, it's crazy.
We're gonna
Hallelujah.
Lift him higher, 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 higher. It feels so good just praising you, Lord.
Seated, glory. I don't care what anybody says. There is no place I would rather be than here with you, celebrating the life and the resurrection of Jesus Christ on a Wednesday night. Amen. Praise God. I want to thank every one of you that's here tonight. We bless you in the name of the Lord. We thank God that you've chosen to join us in the house of God. And worship is more than just a thing we talk about. Amen. Worship is something that we do. And one of the greatest things that I ever encountered as far as truth from the Word of God was when I discovered that giving was an act of worship. Somebody said, oh, well, it's inevitable. They have a service and they've got to take an offering. Yeah, that's right. That's right. We may take two offerings tonight. Praise God. Not because we need it, but maybe because you need it. I went out and looked at my garden the other day, and I was extremely disappointed because there wasn't a thing growing. Of course, that's not unusual for me. We don't have many plants. We kill them. My mother-in-law said the other day, boy, you got some pretty flowers out back. I said, yeah, they're weeds. She said, they're almost as high as your deck. I said, I know. That's what grows around here best. But you know why I don't have anything growing in my garden? It's because I didn't plant anything. And I guess I shouldn't be too disappointed, but I couldn't even get any weeds to grow there this year. I don't know what went wrong. But I sure didn't plant anything, and so I'm not really expecting a harvest. The more seed you plant, the more harvest you have a right to expect. And the more harvest you reap into your own life, the more able you are to sow into the lives of others. And I want you to know that we have expanded our opportunities to sow here since the beginning of this year. And one thing that we're sowing for specifically is to see family members, friends, and loved ones come into the kingdom of God. Now, I don't know about you, but that graduation service that we had here the Sunday before last, it did something for me. Because there were friends and family members from all over the place. There were friends and family members of the graduates of World Harvest Bible Institute that even the graduates didn't expect to be here. And they came and they heard the Word of God and they were saved as a result of the Word of God penetrating their heart. Now that's why we're sowing. Amen. That's why we're sowing. We expect to make a difference not only in our lives but in the lives of those around us. One of the greatest things that you can, mistakes that you can make in the midst of a crisis is focusing your attention on yourself. Because when you do that, you invite disaster. It causes all kinds of problems. And it is essential when you're in the midst of a crisis that you focus your attention somewhere beyond yourself. Because you come to the end of your own resources. Amen?
Amen.
You get to the point where you don't know what else to do. Yes. And you know you're in a very good position when you don't know what else to do, because that means you're very likely to call on somebody who does know what to do. His name is Jesus.
Yes.
But you need his hand to reach into your situation and change things.
Yes,
there.
Amen.
And one of the ways that you can do that is by letting something go out of the midst of your situation. And we're going to give you an opportunity to do that right now. We're going to give you an opportunity to give into this ministry, this local church. How many of you believe in the local church? Praise God. It's going to become more and more vital in the days to come. I am convinced that it will. And we're going to see the importance of the strength and the stability of a local body of believers more in the days ahead than we ever have in the past. But I'm going to give you an opportunity right now. We're going to give you an opportunity to give into this local ministry. Your tithes and offerings are for the support of the local ministry. And there may be those of you tonight that have gifts to be given to Breakthrough. You may have a gift to be given to Feed the Hungry. You can put that in one of those pink envelopes that's there in the pew in front of you. Your regular tithes and offerings, I say regular because that distinguishes them from gifts that are given to other things, go in the green envelopes that are in the pew in front of you. If you're making out a check tonight, make it payable to World Harvest Church. We're going to believe God together, and we're going to thank God together for the opportunity he's given us to come together in this local body of believers and make a difference, not only in our lives, but in the lives of those around us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Take your offering in your hand. We're going to believe God for it. Speak the word of God over it. And believe it to multiply in the name of Jesus. Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for the privilege you've given us, and what a privilege it is to be called the children of God. And Father, as children, we want to glorify you because you're our Heavenly Father. And we acknowledge that you are our Heavenly Father by returning a portion of that you've blessed us with back into your kingdom. We acknowledge our sonship. We acknowledge your lordship by so doing. And we thank you, Heavenly Father, that these gifts that we give freely, you receive. And you multiply our seed sown and cause a harvest of righteousness in our lives and in the lives of those around us. And God, we desire to be used as instruments of righteousness in your hand. And we ask that you multiply our seed sown and increase the fruits of our righteousness, because you said you would in your word. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen. Amen. Give us unto the Lord and enjoy the worship team.
How many believe there's a healer in the house tonight? You know that Jesus Christ still heals like he did back in the Old Testament, New Testament. Sing with me. There's a healer in the house today, and for you he's gonna make a way. You just ask and believe, by faith receive. There's a healer in the house today. I said there's a healer in the house today, and for you he's gonna make a way. You just ask and believe, by faith receive. There's a healer in the house today. It was told that the holy healer, he was passing by one day. Well, there was a man who was afflicted, but he had the faith to say, if I could ever get to Jesus, my healing will be the proof. If I can get through the door, I'll tear on the roof. Cause there's a healer in the house today. Oh, there's a healer in the house today, and for you he's gonna make a way. You must ask and believe, by faith receive. There's a healer in the house today. But he had the faith to say, if I could ever get to Jesus, my healing will be the proof. If I can't get through the door, I'll tear off the roof. Cause there's a healer in the house today. Well, there's a healer in the house today, and for you he's gonna make a way. You just ask and believe, by faith receive. There's a healer in the house. Listen to me now. Or you're feeling lonely, you see I have good news to bring. Well, I know a man, his name is Jesus, and to me he's the King of all kings. When he rides on the wind of mercy, and there's healing in his wings. So tell the room of your doubt, let your faith come out. There's a healer in the house today. Well, there's a healer in the house today.
Just for a moment. God doesn't ever leave us alone or comfortless. Actually, when Jesus said that to his disciples there, the word was orphans. He doesn't leave us orphans. Thank God we never have to feel alone when we're together. Amen. God has always provided someone with a word from God that will minister to us anytime we gather together. And God has prepared vessel to deliver the word of God to us tonight. He's someone that I've known for many years. You may not know this, but he's been coming to church here almost as long as I have. And somebody said, well, how long have you been coming to church here? Well, that doesn't make any difference, but long time. Long enough to know it's one of the best places on earth to go to church, glory to God. But he joined us on staff a little over 2 years ago, and he's been a continual blessing to us ever since then. Would you please welcome Brother Ted Walters as he comes.
Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Woo! It's good to be back with you folks. I had to be gone over the weekend. And I'm glad to be back home. Praise the Lord. You may be seated. I got a long ways to go. Dear mercy. Sunday night, I preach till 10:30. So I better get a real running start here because I got to be finished a lot sooner than that tonight. Glory to God. Woo! I was in Fort Lauderdale, Florida. That's all right in the wintertime, but it's a different ball game this time of the year. But anyway, we had a great move of the Holy Spirit, and I understand you did too. Tonight we're going to deal with the subject of how do you get God in your city. In Hebrews chapter 11, the Bible tells us that there was a man by the name of Abraham who looked for a city whose builder and maker is God. And lower in that same chapter, the Word of God says that he considered himself a pilgrim. He considered himself a pilgrim. Now, the word pilgrim kind of fell into disrepute during the Word and Faith revival. I've been known to make fun of it too. But then I found out what the word pilgrim meant, and I had a little better respect for it. The word pilgrim means a fear of settling down. A fear of settling down, a fear of becoming complacent, a fear of becoming stagnant. Oh, I tell you, I like that. And then the Word of God tells us in Jeremiah that there was a man by the name of Moab. Actually, it was a nation of Moab. They speak of him as a man. And God spoke of the nation of Moab, and he made this statement. He said, Moab stinks and Moab tastes bad because Moab has been sitting on his lees. Now, that's a wine-making term. In making wine, it's necessary to change the vessel or to stir the wine, to change it, or else it will not lose some of its own odor. That scripture in Jeremiah says, Moab has his own smell still in him. He has his own taste still in him. Because he has sat upon his lees, he has become the opposite of a pilgrim. He has settled down. He has become stagnant. He has gotten to the place where nothing stirs him, nothing moves him, nothing causes him to have any kind of a transfer of spirits. And so what he has his own taste. And he has his own smell. Now, I just want to be honest with you. You don't know much about me. You think I'm just a real nice, super nice guy. But I'm here to tell you that without Jesus, I stink. Without Jesus, I have a terrible taste. Anytime I get outside of Christ, I tend to be a real, real bad person to get along with. I know that may be hard for some of you to understand. Others of you probably can comprehend it a little more readily. Yeah. Oh, don't look there so sanctimonious. You stink too unless God stirs you up occasionally. That's the reason why we come in here and in service and we do everything we can to keep you from settling down. We want to keep you a spiritual pilgrim. We want to get you moving around here. We want to get you to the place where the power of the Holy Ghost gets inside and grabs your heart and massages it. Glory to God. Got it on the microphone. That's pretty good, I tell you. Praise the Lord. Okay. Ooh, that's better. That's more gooder. I can put that in my sock.
Some of you wish I would. I'm not going to. You're liable to settle down. But Abraham was looking for a city whose builder and maker was God. He wants to change things. He's not happy with what he sees. And then I look over in Revelation. And John says in Revelation, I saw the holy city Jerusalem coming down, the new Jerusalem coming down out of heaven. Now, in one sentence, he says the two words that are probably as antagonistic as any two words in the English language. He says the word holy, and he says the word city. Now, I told you one time, I came from the city of Pensacola, Florida, and we have a large naval base there, and we had a large contingent of naval intelligence, and we used to, the boys there were jealous of the sailors, of course, the girls went for their uniforms, and so we were jealous of them, and so we used to make the statement, you can't say naval and intelligence correctly, grammatically, in the same sentence. And I want to give you one that's a little bit harder to go than that. You can't say the word holy and city in the same sentence and make sense. John said he saw a holy city. I want to ask you a question. Is Columbus holy? I hope to shout it's not. It is not holy. It's full of all things that are defiling and all things that are degrading. There's a lot that's not holy. But John goes into it and he says, I want you to know, and is it a shaky city? Do we worry and hear about the economy? Are we concerned about the things that the rest of America is concerned about? Yes, we are. But John said, he saw a city that had foundations. He saw a city that's not shaky. A city that is not dependent upon the wands and the wimps of economy of a world that's gone to hell in a handbasket. A city that's stable, something that you can depend on. John said he saw a holy city. He saw a place where there was nothing vile, nothing evil, nothing degrading. He saw a place where that had foundations, a place where people don't call themselves New Yorkers or Londoners or Parisians. They call themselves overcomers. Hallelujah. Glory to God, this is in my heart. There is a place like that. And the Bible said Abraham wasn't satisfied with what he could find here on this planet. He wasn't satisfied with what he could see. He walked and talked with God, and he said, this is not enough. I'm looking for a place where I can go, hallelujah, whose builder and maker is God, hallelujah. I'm looking forward to that. I'm not one that just, I'm not a grin and bear it quitter. But I want you to know, my heart is palpitating in anticipation of the day whenever in the eastern sky Jesus will come. Hallelujah. Some golden daybreak Jesus will come, and he'll take me home to be with him, and I won't have to worry about the city that I live in. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Oh, hallelujah. But before you get the idea that it's some kind of a wimpy resort city of eternal idleness, I want to tell you something. 12 in the Bible is always the number of service. 6 is the number of man. You take that and multiply it times 3, and you've got the number of the Antichrist. Imperfection, imperfection, imperfection. 7 is the perfect number. It's the number of God. And 12 is the number of service. And we're talking about a city that has 12 gates. We're talking about a city that has 12 apostles. We're talking about a city that has 12 tribes. We're talking about a city that has 12 pearls. Glory to God. We're talking about a place where we worship our God. A place where we serve. I'm not sure exactly what I'm going to do. I halfway believe that if I couldn't preach, it wouldn't be heaven. I'm expecting that opportunity. I enjoy it. I believe that I'm going to get a chance to preach, but I am here to tell you, I am going to have something to do in that city that's going to occupy my time. Glory to God. It's a place of beauty. Oh, hallelujah. The best that John could do was to sum it up with a series of negatives. Well, we have negatives in our city. We have no passing, no parking, no walking, no loitering, and no stopping. I like John's list of negatives. He says there's no death, no sorrow, no crying, no pain, no hunger, no thirst, no night, no sun, no moon, and no sin. Hallelujah! Glory to God! Woo! This is in me. Glory to God. Abraham had a nephew whose name was Lot. Now, Abraham was looking for a city whose builder and maker was God. And the very best he ever found on this planet, Brother Clint, was a place called Salem. And there was a king of Salem by the name of Melchizedek. And we find that Abraham paid tithes to him. He was a man of distinction, a man with a priesthood likened to the Lord Jesus Christ. But the Bible tells me that Lot looked at another city. It says that Lot pitched his tent towards Sodom. Now, the picture I want to draw for you tonight is this. You have a choice in this life. Now, we're looking forward to that city. We're looking forward to heaven. But in this life, you have a choice between Sodom or Salem. You've got a choice. You've got a choice. You can choose that which is holy, or you can choose that which is degrading. You can choose that which is above board and that which is enlightened, or you can choose that which is disgusting. Oh, we take the picture of Lot. He pitches his tent toward Sodom and he moves into the city. The Bible does pay him the compliment of saying that the righteous soul of Lot was vexed daily. But Lot's in the middle of it. He's in the middle of the commerce of it. He's caught up with it. The sin is all around him. And it obviously didn't vex him enough to get him out of it. I might as well just be real honest about it. It didn't have enough vexation in his spirit to get him out of that filth, to get him out of that place. He stayed just the same. You take Lot's story. He lost his son-in-laws to be. He lost his wife. She looked back and turned to a pillar of salt. And the last chapter I find about him. Now, I believe that God is mercy because of the prayers of his Uncle Abraham. If it wasn't for Uncle Abe, he'd have been in a mess. But I believe because of the testimony of Abraham, I just believe God, that God saved Lot. But the last chapter of his life that is revealed to us in the pages of Holy Writ. Show us a man that is drunken and committing incest and bringing forth a nation that plagued Israel all through time and still plagues them today. I'm here to tell you that there is a penalty for pitching your tent toward the things of the world. There's a penalty for losing your pilgrim spirit, for losing that desire for something more, for something holier, for something higher. Glory to God. A penalty for getting too involved with the commerce of the devil. I want you to know sin still stinks. Sin still horrible in the face of God. The Bible says God cannot countenance sin, which means he cannot look upon it with favor. There's a choice for your sin. It will either be erased by the blood of Jesus, or it will be covered by a place called hell. That's the options you have. You can flirt with it, and you can cuddle up with it if you want to. You can pinch your tent toward it. You can say, well, I got to have a place. Can you see Lot arguing with the angels of God? The angel says, I want to take you to a mountain. I want to get you out of this stinking plain. I want to get you to a place of higher relationship. I want to get you up where the wind is crisp, where the snow is white. I want to get you up where the scent of the pine is in the air. I want to take you to a mountaintop. He says, oh no, please no. Let me have a little bit of a city. Refusing the high place, settling for a cave outside a little city, drunk and in an incestuous relationship. Now, folks, I tell you, that's pitiful. You say, oh, Brother Walters, I'd never go that far. Oh, let me tell you something. The seed of every sin in the world is in your heart if you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ. Every bit of it is. You say, I'd never do that. Oh, listen, you'll do whatever your father tells you to. He doesn't treat his kids good. You'll do whatever your father... I can look back upon my life before I knew the Lord Jesus Christ. And I wouldn't... If anybody had told me, I would have done some of the things I did. You know, I look back on... And it's hard to believe that I was that person, Brother Bill. It really is. I can remember the time whenever I got a high just having a needle stuck in my arm. It didn't even have to have anything in it for me to get high. I've known friends. I've been at parties where they take Jell-O and put it in a syringe and shoot it into their arms because they were so high on acid. That's disgusting. That's disgusting. We talk about the degradation of the homosexuals and the horrible things they do in private that are despicable and should never even be mentioned in private, much less in public. But you see, the thing of it is, God views all sin the same way. Oh, we can become so righteous and indignant about the alcoholic. We can become so righteous and indignant about the one who commits a terrible, heinous sex crime. We can get so indignant about that, but God looks at all sin the same. It's all rebellion against him. The Bible says none of that will have a place in that city. I'm looking for that city, glory to God. And you know, the Bible says if these things are true, then what manner of men ought we to be? What should we be doing? Do you really believe the Word of God? Do you believe Jesus could come at any time? Do you really believe that? Then, my friend, I'll tell you one thing. If you really believe it, you're going to be out telling somebody about Jesus. You're going to be out trying to win somebody to Jesus. You're going to be out trying to turn some of your loved ones away from the path of destruction. If you really believe it, it's going to make a difference in the way you live and the way you act. Are you a fit candidate for that city? The Bible says that in Revelation chapter 21, it says that the ones there are called overcomers. Glory to God. Overcomers. One of the best studies you can ever do is the promise to the overcomer in the book of Revelation. Boy, I mean, there's some rich stuff there. Abraham's looking for a city. But on this earth, he found the best alternative to it. He found a place of holiness and righteousness. And Lot decided he would rather go with the way of the comfort. I don't ever want to get to the place where I lose my pilgrim status. This is not my home. It's not where I plan to spend eternity. I want you to know I want more than just no stopping and no parking. I want no tears and no sin. I want more than just no U-turn. I want no sickness, glory to God. I want the power of God. It takes more. It takes more than pep. It takes more than personality. It takes more than programs. It takes the power of Almighty God to live a holy life. You don't get that by sitting around twiddling your thumbs. I'm looking for a city. I'm looking for a place where I can go. Here we honor great men by naming cities after them. Washington, D.C., Houston, Texas, St. Petersburg. I want you to know that city will be to the honor of the Lord Jesus Christ for eternity. Hallelujah. I want to go. I want to go. I want to do whatever it takes to see to it that I get there. I want you to understand something. I have settled it in my mind. I intend to be a citizen of that holy city. I intend to know what it's like to live in a place that is dictated to by God, not by Satan. Oh, hallelujah. I'm excited about it. There's another man that wanted to improve his city. He wanted to change things. His name was David. You'll remember the story that the Ark of the Covenant had been captured. It wound up in the house of Abinadab. David never was satisfied too far from God. He never was satisfied too terribly far from God. He wanted the presence of the Holy Spirit. I hear him cry out whenever he had sinned. I hear him cry out in his memory of what had happened to King Saul. He tells God, "Oh, take not thy Holy Spirit from me." I hear it ripped out of his soul. He wants to be close to God. So he decides that the thing to do is to go get the Ark of the Covenant and bring it into Jerusalem. Don't you think that's where the Holy Ghost should be? In the very center of your life? It's going to make a difference in your city. I want you to know, you could, and anybody that travels very much knows what I'm telling you is true. You can fly over a city and you can tell what kind of spiritual activity is going on in there. I had a friend of mine that not too long ago went back to New York after having been away for quite some time. And he told me this. He said, "I could not believe the sense of freedom in the spirit whenever I just got over the air of the city of New York. The last time I was there," he said, it was you could hardly think. Have you ever been to the place where your mind was like mush? You know, where if you tried to carry on a conversation, I know I've been in places where I preach like that. My dad's used to say, "Not a brick hit the wall." That meant when everything went over. Well, when the opposite is true, you feel like the words are falling off your lips and you don't know what word you said last. You just keep on going and hope that God puts it together. Well, he said that before, whenever he was in New York, and I've been there, and the feeling was like that. Your mind was just in a maze, and you could feel the satanic activity. He said he got off the plane, and he was amazed at what had transpired. I can tell you what transpired. A man by the name of David Wilkerson went to a theater on Broadway and opened a church that he calls Times Square Church. And the New York Times headlines read, "Jesus Christ is back on Broadway," because Jeff Fenholt went there and sang in the same theater that he had played the part of Jesus in Jesus Christ Superstar. The power of the Holy Ghost has been moving. There's a church in Brooklyn that is turning the city upside down for Jesus.
Jesus. A man by the name of Bill Wilson, one of the greatest Christian educationalists in the world. The man is turning the city upside down. Yes, they have bound the strong man and they are plundering his goods. And I'm here to tell you that you can have the Holy Ghost in the midst of your city and you can buy the strong man. You can plunder his goods. Yes. He went on to say that he had some business over in New Jersey. And he went across the river. And he said it went right just back to where he remembered it was. He said his mind was like a beehive. Just activity. Anybody that's ever conducted a service knows what I'm talking about. When there's satanic activity there, it's almost like bees in the room. Every baby's crying. Everybody's making noise. It's just a stir in the spirit. He said he went over to New Jersey and said he didn't think clearly or spiritually until he got back over in the state of New York. I can tell you what else is happening. There's a guy that started a little theater building right outside of Albany, New York. And that man made the mistake of coming to a Dominion camp meeting. He came here. I'm going to tell you exactly what took place. His wife told me the story. He came here and he sat right there on Pastor's pew. Pastor Parsley stood in this pulpit and he looked down. Pastor's always, he likes to give things and sometimes he even trades things. And he just pulled out a pen out of his pocket, a very nice pen, I might add. And he looked at the brother and he said, what kind of pen you got? And the brother pulled out a gold cross pen. He said, you're getting the better of the deal. Let's trade. And he handed him a pen that was worth probably 3 to 5 times as much as the purchase price of the pen. That's not the important thing, though. And then he walked over to me and said, Ted, what kind of pen you got? And I had a Bic. And so he gave me the cross pen, and I got it at home and value it tremendously. But that pastor's wife told me that he came back. I'm talking about, you know, just a quiet New York kind of guy. You know, Clint Yankee. And I've been up here in almost 10 years, so I've lost the grammatical necessity of adding a word, a descriptive word with Yankee that they always put in down south. I no longer do that. I don't do that anymore. I've gotten saved and sanctified. I don't do that. But I want you to know, this guy's just a Yankee. I mean, his preaching's not Southern fried preaching. Dear God. And he's quiet, down to earth, had a New York accent, that brogue. Sounded a whole lot like they all sounded whenever I was in Fort Lauderdale. You do know why it doesn't snow in Florida. Too many Yankees praying that it won't. Anyway, he comes back to his little church, a nice little growing church in a theater building right outside of the state capital of New York. And he brings that pen with him. You tell me there's no such thing as tangible anointing, I'll tell you, you're crazy as you can get. There is a tangible anointing. There is anointing in objects. I guarantee you of that. I've got a handkerchief that I loaned the pastor 2 years ago. And he wiped his face with it around the altar here. I got it in a plastic bag in the top drawer of my dresser, and it still got an electrical charge on it. That's the truth. He handed that back to me, and I felt like somebody handed me the end of an electrical wire. Anyway, this pastor comes back, and his wife says he starts walking the pews and starts screaming and hassling and starts acting just like we do around here, glory to God. And the power of the Holy Ghost came down and sent revival. And he's got a 1,300-seat sanctuary that he's built since he plugged into the anointing of Holy Ghost in this place. It's happening all over the country. I love dearly, that's why I'm gone some. I love dearly going into these churches that have plugged in to this anointing.
They found out that you can put the Holy Ghost in the center of your city, glory to God, and it'll bind the strong man. It'll put Satan out of business, glory to God. If it don't make a holy city out of it, it certainly makes it a holier city. Glory to God. David wanted that power in his city. He said, let's go get that thing. So he went down to Abinadab's house, and they got the Ark of the Covenant. Of course, he did it wrong. David reminds me a lot about Simon Peter, but I'll leave that alone right now. But David did it wrong. Put the Ark on a new cart. They got halfway back to Jerusalem and looked as though the thing was going to fall off. One of David's mighty men reached out to steady it, and the power of God struck him dead. Now, I don't know. Somehow, Brother Clint, I wonder if that brother, I don't know if he's lost or not, or if he just got more of the Holy Ghost than he could handle right then. If you got to die, that would have to be a way to go. I'm just not real sure. I don't know if we'll see that guy when we get to heaven or not. I just wonder if he just didn't get an OD of the Holy Ghost. Woo! Wouldn't that be a wonderful way to go home, Elijah? Glory to God. We got this tremendous surge of power, and David says, anything I can't control, I don't want around. And you see, that's the problem with so many people. They want Jesus to come into their neighborhood, into their home, and into their city, but they want to be able to control him. They want to put him in a box and turn him loose on Wednesday night or in a back room someplace. I am here to tell you the Holy Ghost won't fit in your box. Just when you think you've got him in a box, he'll sneak out and he'll turn over the filing cabinet in your office and he'll wreak havoc on the place. He will not fit into your box. God's glory never needs a denominational reflector. I said it. Doesn't need some kind of a religious reflector to make his glory shine. It shines by itself. Hallelujah. Well, David throws a temper tantrum. Looks around and says, we can't leave the Holy Ghost out in the middle of nowhere. And he looks all around and he sees this dumb looking thing by the name of Obed-Edom. He sees this guy. And if this doesn't fit your imagination, please just bear with me for the next few minutes. I see him with a straw hat on, barefooted with the overalls, with one unbuttoned, and with a straw in his mouth. And I'm sorry. If that bothers you, I'm just sorry. That's the way I picture this guy. I mean, he just doesn't have any idea that he is in the most gloriously propitious spot in all of God's universe. He is under the spout where the glory is about to pour out. Hallelujah. He's there. David says, Obed, if I remember correctly, you got a spare bedroom. He says, yep. He said, how about you take this Ark of the Covenant down in your spare bedroom? He said, yep. And he takes it home. I see Obed-Edom as he long toward dusk dark. He comes out and sits on the front porch. He's rocking in his split cane rocking chair. I just see him as he looks out across the road. You know, corn's supposed to be knee high by 4th of July. But as he's watching it, it grows a foot. All of a sudden, his teenage son runs out and slams the screen door and says, Dad, I got a problem and I really need your advice. That's a greater miracle than the corn growing a foot. And then all of a sudden, his wife comes out and kisses him right smack dab on the lips. And it's not even their anniversary. And the Bible says that in Jerusalem, David heard that Obed-Edom was blessed, and all that pertaineth to him. I want you to know that includes the stock portfolio. That includes the car that you drive. That includes Junior and your daughter. That includes your boss. I want you to know that your place of business is blessed just because you show up on Monday morning. There is a tangible anointing that changes your life. Glory to God. Woo! Hallelujah! And all that pertaineth to him is blessed. Woo! I got a lot needs blessing. I need that ark in the middle of my city. We need a blessed school board. We need a blessed police department. We need a blessed mayor's office. Dear God, we need a blessed Capitol building. Oh my God, have mercy. The senator's offices in this state need to be blessed. We need the Holy Ghost in our Jerusalem. We need him in the midst of us. Oh, Ramahamadishika. The Bible says that David heard about it. He said, I got to go back. I got to get that. And I got to bring it to me. This time he does it right. This time he gets the Levites. And they shoulder the weight upon their shoulders. I'm here to tell you, it's time that the Levites, that the clergy, I is one, so I can talk about us. It's time that the ministers of this city took the weight of the Holy Ghost on their shoulders and brought him back to the center of our government. And it's time the same thing happened in our nation. It's time. It's time that we quit flirting with politics. My God, we had 8 years of almost unlimited access to the White House, and the best we could get was a little joke that said, as long as there's math tests, there'll be prayer at school. We need more than that. We need more than that. We found out that the access isn't through the ballot box, although I do not in any way disparage good citizenship. We need to be the salt that keeps the thing from rotten. We need to be involved. I'm not saying that, but that's not the answer. The answer is to get the Holy Ghost stirred up inside you until you get to the place where you're not like an old stinking keg of wine that had never been turned over. Until you're not like Moab, who's got his own smell in him and his own taste in him. I want my smell gone. I want my taste gone. I want the freshness of the power of the anointing of the Holy Ghost of God. Hallelujah. The only way we get that is to get back in our pilgrim status. Until we get a holy fear of settling down. I'm not going to settle down. I'm not going to get more calm. I'm not going to backslide no matter who wants me to. I'm going to stay stirred up. Hallelujah. I'm a pilgrim. And I'm looking for a city whose builder and maker is God. A holy city. Something this world's never known. They've never known a holy city. But there's one coming. Oh, glory to God. There's one coming. And the Bible says they'll need no sun or moon, for the Lamb will be the light. Ooh, glory to God. But until then, I need to do the best I can to get the Holy Ghost in the center of where I live. Well, how can I do that? The Bible says, in the last days, I will pour out of my spirit upon all flesh. Let's do a little Bible school quiz. Where is the Holy Ghost geographically at this point in time? He is residing in the temple of God. Okay? And that same scripture, you have to read that in Jeremiah. God says, that's all right, Moab. I'm going to send tilters. I'm going to send some tilters. And you know what my prayer is? My prayer is that God, Brother Terry, will send some tilters that'll tilt over the vessels that have this precious treasure in these earthen vessels. And that we, that's the only way God can ever pour out His Spirit on all flesh. He's got to tilt you. He's got to turn you upside down. He's got to pour it out of your vessel. Say, oh my God. Yeah, I don't doubt you would say, oh my God. Every time I stand in that pulpit, before I walk up there, I say, Father, in the name of Jesus, take the hem of the seamless robe of Jesus and wipe the lip of my cup, lest I serve the water of life in a dirty vessel. Some of you don't want to be tilted over. Why? Because what comes out is going to stink like you. You've been sitting too long. It's time you let God empty you out and fill you up with the freshness of His Holy Ghost. David brings the Ark of the Covenant into the city of Jerusalem. You've heard Pastor Parsley preach about it. He dances before the Lord. Everybody doesn't like Holy Ghost revival. I know that is a terrible shock to you. I know that you were under the illusion that everybody loved this great move of God that we're having, but they don't all love it. David's coming into the city. He's dancing before the Lord. He has disrobed himself of the robes of kingly office, and he's taken upon himself the robe of a priest. And there he is. The Bible says David spun. But what it means is he twirled off the ground. Now, you figure out how that's done. Now, if they figure out a song and start making us do that around here, they're going to have to leave me out. I don't think I can do that. He jumps off the ground and spins in midair and lands back down. He obviously was anointed. Well, he's coming along and sure as you know it, looking out her room is the booby prize for giant killing. Michael. David has a great revival. Now, he makes a mistake. I'm not going to be totally mean to Michael. He does make a mistake. And God got a hold of me and made me see that. But Michael's got a wrong attitude about what David's doing. Now the Bible says David serves a piece of bread, a piece of flesh, meat, and a flagon of wine to every household in Israel. And then returns to bless his household also. Now, on those grounds alone, I can find a little bit of forgiveness for Michael. I am here to tell you the first place you need to have revival is in the center of your home. That's where God called you to be first. There's the place where you've got to be tilted out. You've got to pour that Holy Ghost on those kids. Husbands, you've got to pour it on your wife. Wives, you've got to pour it on the biscuits. Glory to God. You've got to have Holy Ghost gravy. And you've got to have Spirit of God molasses. I'm here to tell you, it's time we had a revival in our homes. Get so caught up with serving the whole nation. Bible says, then he returned to bless his family also. God got a hold of me for that. He said, you can't do that. He said, you're not allowed to do that. He really gave me a hard time about it. How much of a hard time, I ain't gonna tell you. It ain't none of your business. But he really did deal with me on that. But she couldn't stand that move of the Holy Ghost. For whatever reason, she was still wrong. And there's a terrible penalty for opposing the move of the Holy Ghost in your city, in your family, and in your life. The scripture says one of the most poignant phrases in the Bible. It says, "And Michael was barren until the day of her death." And I want you to know, opposing the freedom of the Holy Spirit in your life will cause you to have spiritual barrenness. Spiritual barrenness. During the great Chicago fire, I don't remember, it was almost 1,000 people that lost their life in that fire. And one girl was on a streetcar. This was told by someone who was there in a book that I have. And she was screaming hysterically. And they examined her, and she had only superficial burns and a few cuts. And they said, "Ma'am, you're all right. You're safe. Everything's fine. You're not injured. You're safe." And her response was, "Yes, I'm safe, but I saved no one." And she continued in her tears, "I'm saved, but I saved no one." What an indictment. What an indictment against us if we oppose the free reign. How can I yield to the power of the Holy Ghost? Well, it's always been a good way. Look what God's done in the past. Look what he's doing around you. Get in the middle of it and you're in God's will. Boy, isn't that difficult? That is so difficult. I need to write 6 books on that, don't I? Look at what God did in the past. Look at what he's doing now. Get in the middle of it and you'll be in the middle of God's will. You want the power of the Holy Ghost to flow through you? Then do that which is necessary for it to flow through you. Draw a circle on the ground and say, "God, send a revival in this circle. Until my eyes flow with tears. Until my heart weeps within me. Until the outgushings of the Holy Ghost flow through me and into the world around me." That's what God is calling us to do. Abraham looked for a city. I'm looking for that city too. But in the meantime, I'm going to brighten the corner where I are. I'm going to see to it that I make an impact on this world in which I live. Hallelujah. Is that what your desire? You want to make a difference? You want to see the Holy Ghost move? You want to see a tangible change? Now, folks, I'm not talking about a little wimpy revival. I'm talking about something that changes this city from center to circumference. Until you have the up and outs and the down and outs, you have the filthy rich and the filthy and everything in between. Amen. Is that what you want? Is that the desire of your heart? Amen. Stand to your feet with me. And pray this prayer with me now out loud. Say it with your own mouth where your ears can hear it. Say this. Say, "Heavenly Father, I purpose in my heart to be used mightily for you. I want the Holy Ghost to flow through me. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. He died for my sins. I believe that in my heart. He was raised from the dead. I believe that in my heart. And I confess it with my mouth. The Bible says I'm saved. The Bible says I'm saved. It also says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. I'm gonna say so. I'm gonna say it loud. I'm gonna say it clear. I'm gonna make a difference. In Jesus' name. Amen.
I surrender all. Oh, I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all.
Can you lift up your hands and sing it tonight?
To invite the network team leaders to join me down here at the front. Those of you here tonight, you need prayer for anything at all in your life. Things aren't going as you expect them to or as you want them to. You want someone to agree with you and someone to believe God for you in prayer. That's why these people are here. They'll pray, they'll believe God with you, and they'll expect God through His Spirit to make a difference in your life. Hallelujah. Got just a couple of announcements before we're dismissed. There was a meeting scheduled tomorrow night for all children's ministry camp meeting volunteers, and that meeting has been canceled. It was scheduled for tomorrow night, Thursday, June the 18th. That meeting has been canceled. Also, on Friday night, June 19th, the World Harvest Bible Institute students are having a tremendous night of praise and worship. And it's just going to be a tremendous opportunity for you to come and participate in some anointed praise and worship and special music. And it'll be at the Bible Institute building on Wright Road. It begins at 7 p.m. You're going to have praise and worship, a number of guests that are going to be coming and sharing with you in special music. And then after they're finished over there, they're going to come over here to the cafeteria where you can have fellowship and also refreshments. And so we haven't had an opportunity to say a lot about that, and we wanted to make sure that you knew about it and that you were invited. That's Friday night, June 19th at 7 p.m. at the Bible Institute building at Wright Road. They're going to begin at 7. When they're finished there, they're going to come on over here to the cafeteria in D Wing and enjoy some fellowship and refreshments. I also want to remind you about camp meeting coming up July the 5th through the 10th. Now, we've got people coming in from all over the United States and all around the world, and we want them to feel welcome and feel appreciated. And the funny thing about people in a home church, when it hosts special meetings, they think, well, there's no room for me there. Well, we guarantee you there's room for you here, but you got to get here to find out whether there is or not and where it is you're going to sit. Amen. And if you've never been to a service at World Harvest Church where we've had folding chairs, well, you just need to come and experience what it's like. Amen? We're going to pack this place out wall to wall and from floor to ceiling with people that are turned on to God, shouting, screaming, dancing, praising, and believing God for change to be made in people's lives. And you need to be a part of it. Hallelujah. So that's coming up. Be sure to mark your calendars and be here, because we are going to have a tremendous time. We're also going to have a tremendous time on Sunday morning. Pastor Rod Parsley is going to be back with us. We want you to be here. And we're going to be thanking God and praising God together. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, do you love Jesus with all your heart? Amen. Glory to God. Go your way rejoicing. Be blessed. Be back with us on Sunday morning. And until then, remember these words.
Well, I've been changed. I've been newborn. All of my life has been rearranged.